This is what we have been waiting for. This has been in my heart, it's been in God's heart, it's a part of his plan. In fact, it's a command. Not the partial reducing, but wait for the power. Which God said he. John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. So we can go preach this wonderful gospel. We've been trying to figure it out for years. Finally, God put it in my heart. Pastor Saeed, he's been doing this, and we've seen him just recently up in Dream Center Church. So simple, but yet so powerful. The simple message, so. Dr. Saeed, will you come up here and open the Word of God?
Well, good morning, good morning. God bless each and every one of you. What a wonderful, wonderful privilege it is for my wife and I, Pastor Cynthia, to come here. We love coming here. We love ministering over here. And Pastor Walt, I hope I look as good as you when I'm your age. I want to look just like you when I grow up. Miss Lee, what can I say? It must be all the great love that he receives from you that keeps him so young. And broccoli, too. Okay. Broccoli. Well, we just thank God for each and every one of you, all the testimonies we heard today and all the wonderful, wonderful things. And Overflow, we love you just as much over there, even though we can't see you. But how many of you have never heard me talk before, speak before? Oh, so about half of you and some of you in the other room, I can't see. But since we heard testimonies today, I would like to give a part of my testimony into this because it's very important to the whole story of why am I here today? Why are we here today? Most people in this place, your testimony is, well, I was down and out, I was in the street, I got saved when I was in the gutter, and the Lord Jesus reached down and saved me, and boy, what a glorious day that was. It wasn't like that for me. As a matter of fact, I was at the height of my success, at the height of making money and being successful and all that, yet I was so empty because of what I was looking for to make me happy. When we first got married, by the way, I know some of you have this question, so I'm going to answer it for you. You look at me and you go, his name is Saeed. It kind of sounds like Arabic, but he looks Mexican. What's up with that? I had that question asked all my life. I was born in Iran. I came to the States here to go to school in 1973, and back then nobody knew where Iran was. So when people ask me, where are you from? I tell them, I'm from Iran. They go, are you Arab? I go, Arab, don't call me Arab. I'm Persian. The Persian tribe would come out of me. Don't call me Arab. Well, something happened in 1979 when we had the hostage crisis. Boy, back then, all of a sudden, things were happening. Everybody knew where Iran was. I was going to college at the time. I was crossing the campus one day, and I got the daylights beat out of me just because I was from Iran. So after that, when they thought I was Arab, I didn't make an issue out of it. I was quiet. I was safe as an Arab until September 11, 2001. That awful day and awful things that happened. One of those names that would pop up on the TV screen was almost exactly like mine. Well, at the time, we lived here in Arizona. So when people thought I was Mexican, I said, si, senor, gloria a Dios. I was safe as an Arab until I was safe as a Mexican until recently. I have to tell you, we live in Arizona, so all these problems. So now it's like I was kind of running out of things to be. Earlier this year, we were in Minot, North Dakota. By the way, it's a lot colder than 20 degrees. Last year, it was so cold. My coffee in the car, by the time we came out of the church, was solid ice. Okay, it was below zero and blowing everywhere. So we were in Minot, North Dakota, so I told that same story. I said, I'm running out of things to be. One of the sisters came up to me in peace service and said, figure out what you can be. You can be one of us. I go, what's that? He said, American Indian. So I looked at her, I said, how? She looked at me funny. funny. She said, I don't think we say that anymore. I said, no, I'm asking you. How? Help me. I need help. So I'm running out of things to be, so if you can help me, you know, see me after service, I would appreciate that. I'm running out of options. When we first got married, I was a Muslim. And my wife was a Mormon. See, that right there tells you there's a God. We are the original M&M couple. Some of you remember when we taught class over here, I brought everybody my calling card, which was a bag of M&M's. So here's our calling card, M&M's. Well, in 1979 is the year that we got married, by the way. Okay? Yes. And I was a junior in college. And by the way, it was a spiritual experience when we met, but it wasn't the right kind of spirit. We actually met in a bar. I saw her across the bar, and my eyes locked up on her. I went over and asked her to dance, and I'm happy to say we've been dancing now for the last 40 years. And the Lord showed me this morning when I was sitting there about my testimony, it was March of 1987 when I gave my heart to the Lord. So it'll be 30 years this March. Amen. So after we got married, I started delivering pizza. I graduated college with a computer science degree, but back in the 70s, computers are not what they are today. So I couldn't get a job. So I started delivering pizzas for Domino's. Make a long story short, I became a manager. I became a supervisor, and we franchised in North Section of Chicago. We were the first franchisees outside Chicago. We had the whole area. Success came so fast. And when I came here, what drove me was success and fame. I wanted to be famous, and I wanted to have money. So those things drove me. So therefore, I finished my college. My dad had not seen me for several years. And when he found out I was delivering pizzas after going to college, he was so disappointed at me, he called me an overeducated pizza boy. But let me tell you, that made me determined to want to make me successful. So anyway, we franchised in Chicago, and success came so fast. Boy, it came so fast. We opened the first store. It just went crazy, because back then delivery was a novelty. And in Chicago, being snow, we're the only things on the road at times. The only cars on the road were our Domino's signs. So success came real fast, one store after another, one after another. And those things that I planned for myself for 20 years came to pass within 2 or 3 years. So now I'm thinking, what next? Another house, another store, another watch, another car, another this, and as soon as I get it, it was so empty. So now I'm running around, very successful, have everything, but I'm dying on the inside, I have nothing. Something's missing. And I'm trying to put these things in here from the world, but nothing was fitting. So, one day, I'm driving my brand new Maserati that I had just bought. I'm sitting in there and I'm thinking, man, I have arrived. This is it. I walked in there, 27 years old, paid cash for a Maserati, walked out of the showroom. Boy, a couple days later, I'm sitting at a red light, smoking a joint. And don't look at me like you're so lily-white, okay? Sitting there in my new Maserati smoking a joint, and all of a sudden I started crying. What's wrong with me? What is wrong with me? I don't know. I thought this was gonna make you happy. You've been looking for this. What's going on? All of a sudden I felt that there was a presence in the car talking to me, like asking me, what's wrong with you? Oh, I don't know. I'm talking out loud. I don't know. I think I'm going crazy. I'm high. I don't know. It's like asking, take an inventory of your life. What's wrong with you? You got a pocket full of money. You got the car of your dream. You have the wife of your dream. You have the business of your dream. What is wrong with you? I don't know. Well, I went home that day. And when we got married, I told my wife, never bring religion into this house. I'm a Muslim, you're a Mormon. I don't want anything to do with religion, because growing up as a Muslim, I saw, and I didn't want anything to do with it. So I go home that day, my wife's sitting, what is she doing? She's sitting on the floor, reading the Bible, which her father had left to her a couple months before that he had passed. Was reading the Bible to her, to our son. Boy, I was high, so I freaked out. I said, what do you think you're doing, et cetera, et cetera. I left the house, never wanted to come back again. Checked into the hotel room down the street, but 5 o'clock in the morning, that same voice came to me in the hotel. What are you doing? What do you think you're doing? You're either gonna lose everything you got, or you better make a decision right now, okay? So I went back home after a few days of not talking. We finally talked, and we started saying, well, we've tried everything else in our life. What? My wife said, let's try God. Okay. While I was open, she's been going to this church that she found out in the paper, Assembly God Church, that she had been going to, and it was an Easter program, et cetera, so she went to. So I said, okay, after a long time, I said, all right, I was ready to go. She would ask me from time to time if I wanted to go, and I'd say no. But something in the back of my mind would say, I hope you don't stop asking me, because someday I may want to go. Well, that day I was ready. That Sunday we went into the church. We walk in, they were a small church, and we walk in there, and I'm like, my gosh, this is not what I thought church was going to be. They had drums, they had guitars. I really liked it. The atmosphere was very happy, and people come up, hug me, say, I love you, very genuine. I go, man, I like this, you know? Wow, so I kept going back. Something kept having me go back. I went back. Well, after about 9 months or so, the struggle between my head, what I had been learned from a child, and what my heart was so bad. My heart was telling me one thing, my head was telling me another. I couldn't even say the name of Jesus, being a Muslim. Every time they said Jesus, I would replace it with God, I would sing it, I was okay with it. So I told the Lord, I said, now the struggle is getting really bad, God. I really need today to know you're real. Either you're real or you're not. If I don't hear today, either I'm coming back or I'm not coming back. But that day, of all things, they gave a message in tongues from the pulpit. Now, up to this point, tongues freaked me out. I tolerated tongues because the people were so nice. I could overlook the tongue part because everything else was good. But that day, when they gave a message in tongues, we heard it today, and the interpretation came. My. When interpretation came, I heard it in my language, in my understanding. Saeed, it was as though God was pointing his finger between my eyes. He'd asked if I was real. I am real. So, if you want to know more, come to the altar.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, up to this point, I wanted to answer the altar call so many times, but it sounds like every time I wanted to get up, my legs were chained to the pew. I just couldn't do it. Or there was a ton of weight pushing me down. But that day, no chain, no weight, nothing was going to hold me up. Instantly he became real. So I go to the altar and I go, yes, can I help you, brother? I go, I want to meet Jesus. I want to meet. By the way, I used to tell the story like we would say here, I found Jesus on such and such day. I mean, I gotta tell you this, he was never lost. We were lost. So that day, Jesus found me. Okay? He'd been looking for me. He said, I came and seek and save that which was lost. So that day, he found me and we connected. So I said, what do I need to do? They said, oh, say this prayer. Just repeat this prayer after me. I said the prayer to go, hallelujah, you got it. I go, what? You got saved. I go, that's it? That's it? Where do I pay? What do I do? Because to me, concept of grace was unknown. As a Muslim, you do and you hope to get. And you never know whether you've done enough. So to me, I thought, well, this didn't work. I tried it, didn't work, okay. So I went home. I realized something had happened. The first time I picked up an alcoholic drink, I'm like, ooh. I would start thinking about what I was doing. When I would get high, I'd be miserable. What used to make me happy, all of a sudden started to feel bad. So I knew something had happened. And frankly, I didn't like it because I didn't enjoy the stuff that I used to like. Something was changing in me. So this struggle now became really, really heavy because, listen, I was saved, but I didn't know how to live a saved life. Amen. I didn't have the power. I didn't know what to do. Yes, I was saved. I said the sinner's prayer. I got it by grace, all that, yes. But I was a defeated. I did not know how to live a saved life. So one day, my pastor said, we're going to teach on the baptism of the Holy Spirit for 6 weeks. And after that, we're going to give you an opportunity to come and receive it. After the first week, I'm like, why do I need to wait 5 more weeks? If it's real, give it to me now. Well, I waited. Being a good sheep that I was, I waited. After the 6th week was over, I went up front. I was the first one again. What do you want? See, I was like a child. If he told me to do this, I did it. I didn't try to figure it out. Okay? I went up front. They go, okay, we're going to, what do you want? I want to receive this baptism in the Holy Spirit. Okay, we're going to pray for you. And we're going to lay hands on you. You're going to feel like babbling. I go, well, I can babble. That's all I got to do. So they lay hands on me and I started babbling. Go, oh, hallelujah, you got it. I go, I got what? You got the Holy Spirit. That's it? I've been sitting there for 6 weeks listening to you about fire, about power. I feel nothing. Because I was taking everything literally. I thought I was going to become Arnold Schwarzenegger and have fire. I took everything literally. But none of that happened. No feeling changed, nothing changed. So I'm like, man, I wasted 6 weeks of my time listening to you. Okay, I guess I tried it, didn't work. I go home. Now, up to this point, I was saved. I read and spoke English very well. But when it came to the Bible, I would read it. It was as though it was Chinese. I would read it. I couldn't understand what he was telling me. I would have to read it over and over and over. First time I picked up the Bible, it jumped out at me like it was talking to me. As God is my witness, I looked at my wife and said, did someone translate this book? Did someone? Because I can understand it. Then I knew something had happened.
Amen.
I knew something had happened. Then the Bible became like food. I became like a sponge. I wanted to read because I could understand. Then, now by then, we had several stores. But chasing after God became my pursuit. I was no longer a world chaser. I was a God chaser. Business started to take second place, back seat. Little by little, things started to change. Make a long story short, 1994, the Lord spoke and said, I want you to sell all your stores, all your businesses, and I want you, I'm going to move you. We prayed about it. Things to happen just like that. Within 60 days, everything was done. Boom, boom. Okay, Lord, we're ready to go. Where are you moving us? Silence. What happened, God? 2.5 years of silence. So I started questioning everything, my sanity. God, why did you tell me to sell your stores that I was making money hand over fist? Why? Did I make a mistake? Did I hear you wrong? The Lord said, no, you heard me right. Are you moving us? Yes, moving you. Where? Silence. When?
Silence.
Guys, I mean, it was like, nothing. Lord, what's going on? What do you do when you don't know what to do? You pray. Hey, we knew we had a large 7,000 square foot house, okay? What do? We don't have a job. We don't work. Let's have prayer meetings at our home. So we started having prayer meetings at our home. Again, I'm making a long story very short because I want to get to the meat of it. Anyway, that's how God started teaching us how to pray. We put a CD in the CD player and we would just gather around. We would have 10, 15, 20, whatever, however many people we have prayer. God was training us for 20 years later when he moved us to Arizona. We had no clue. Why? That's where we got all of our training, on our knees. Then he made it very clear 2.5 years later. They said it's got to be the right time also when God wants to do something. You have to be the right person in the right place, and it has to be the right time. We were the right people. We were in the right place, but it wasn't the right time. God was preparing something. So when he said move to Arizona, somebody said, come, make sure you go visit Tommy Barnett's church. So we walk in the second floor up there, and oh my goodness, the Spirit of God hit us. Both of us started crying. Couldn't stop. We knew God had brought us there. We went back and everything started to shape up. We saw things back. I mean, everything just started clicking. Our house that we couldn't sell for 2 years and nobody looked for it, in 2 weeks sold. When God was ready. So we moved to Arizona now. Okay, God, you brought us here. You said I got great plans. What do you got? What are you going to do? Again, We got involved with the ministry. We got involved with deacon ministry. With every ministry that needed us, we got involved, volunteered. Somebody said, you got to do that or you're going to get lost in the church. Well, we started volunteering, and then things weren't moving fast enough. I'm like, God, you're not moving fast enough. So, went and got a business, bought a business in Scottsdale. Equipment rental, et cetera, et cetera. Because I couldn't wait on God. So then, I'm in the business, it's a good business, et cetera, et cetera. But all I can think about sitting there towards the end is ministry. All I'm thinking about is the church, I'm in the business. Again, once again, see the Holy Spirit. Now I had a connection with the Holy Spirit. He's talking to me. He's telling me. I'm like, God, what are you doing here? See, again, ministry was the final goal, but it wasn't the right time. He was preparing something because some people had to leave for the position to come open. I did not want to be in the ministry. That was the farthest thing. I wanted to minister. I wanted to help, volunteer, but I don't want to be a minister. I'm not a pastor. I'm not a priest. I didn't like priests. I didn't like pastors. I was a businessman. But God said, no, I have a different plan for you. So guess what? My first official day on staff was September 11, 2001. That was my first official day. We walk in the office, everybody's glued to the TV in Pastor Barnett's office, and I feel like a little, what am I doing here, God? You surely made a mistake doing this, God. You got to free me from this. So I talked to Pastor Barnett in the hallway, and I said, Pastor, you haven't told the church yet. So, in light of what has happened, I'm willing to step aside, bring somebody else in. I don't want to bring shame to God or to the church. He said, don't talk like a crazy person. God doesn't make a mistake. We don't understand his timing, but I know he doesn't make a mistake. Get over your fear. And that gave me the courage to start with fear and trembling and started. I fast forward now. A year later, Pastor Barnett preached this message to the whole church. Go to the mountain and pray and ask God what he has for your life. When you find out, you'll give your life for it. So I've been asking that question all along. What am I here for? Went up to the mountain and I said, God, talk to me. What are you bringing me here for? I heard the voice of God. The voice of God says, I brought you here to help your pastor with his vision of the prayer chapel. I said, great. I went down the mountain, couldn't wait to tell Pastor Barnett, Pastor, I figured out what God brought me here to help you with your vision of the prayer chapel. He said, good, go back up there and ask him how he wants you to do it. Because if he talks to you, he'll tell you how to do it. So I went back up there and said, God, Pastor referred me back to you. Talk to me. But let me tell you, if I didn't know the voice of the Holy Spirit, I would not have heard it, these things. See, that's what's important. That's why I'm telling you this. All along the way, God tells you things. Stop. Go. Wait. Not yet. Run. All that. But if you haven't heard his voice, you don't know the voice, you're not going to catch it. So I went back up to the mountain and I said, what do I need to do? God said, give me what's in your hand. What do I have? I said, I don't know. I took an inventory. Again, God said, take an inventory. He said, you have a tent. You have some chairs. That business that we bought rented tents and chairs. So we were able to bring a tent and some chairs. Even God didn't use that business. That's how the prayer pavilion started, with a broken down tent and a chair. And God said, now pick up a rock to remember. Remember, the reason I'm telling you, I have the original rock. It was August 2nd, 2002. Almost 15 years ago when God spoke that. And the rest is history. We have the prayer chapel now. God has been using it now. We live stream to 57 nations. All of that, all the different things, okay? But let me tell you, what if I did not hear the voice of God? And the pastor's dream that he had for 30 years. But see, he had to wait for the right person to hear it come and be willing. See, I had to be willing to step down from the height of my success. Get down into the pit when I had nothing except God to hold on to hear his voice, to come to Arizona. I asked God before, why didn't you just tell me to come to Arizona? Instead of losing all that money, he said you would not have heard me at that time. Because you were up here on your high horse. I had to knock you off so you would hear me. Then when you heard me, you were willing to do what I called you. That was my path for you to come. Plus, the timing was not right. So what if I never received the Holy Spirit that one day, the first day? I would have never been able to hear his voice after that. I told you all of this to tell you, we are here today, and we do what we do today, not because we know what we're doing or we have anything to give to God. It's by the grace and the power of the Holy Spirit. It is all by that. All God is looking for is willing people. Are you willing to not be ruled by your mind? Are you willing to be like a child and believe? That's why it says all it takes is faith, small as a mustard seed. What if that day when they gave the baptism of the Holy Spirit invitation, I said, no, this doesn't make any sense, man. This is crazy. I don't want to do it. Let me tell you, a lot of people have done that. And the reason, there's several different reasons. Baptism of the Holy Spirit has been misused and abused. That's why people are turned off by it. I was turned off by it. That's what I said. I thought it was crazy. And the people that spoke in tongues, I ran from them. I didn't like them. Why? Because they were either legalistic or they were weird. Okay? You don't have to be weird. You don't have to be weird. Listen, you can be live a natural life and be a supernatural person all at the same time. Okay? So a lot of people are turned off by what they have seen and what they have heard, their experience. So right now, I want you to wipe all of that out of your mind. Whatever you heard, whatever your experience has been with the Holy Spirit, right now, just forget it. As though you're hearing it for the first time. Okay? You're hearing it for the first time. You heard my testimony, how it happened to me. And I'm standing here as an example to you. If God can take an ex-Muslim, married to an ex-Mormon, okay, and use them as prayer pastors at Phoenix First Assembly, now Dream City Church, if he can do that, he can use anybody. Okay? We have nothing to point to except the grace of God. We were just willing. We were willing to be like children, to say, okay, God, if you tell me to babble, I'll babble. I may sound foolish, I may look foolish, but if that's the path to what you're saying, I'll do it. A lot of people have tried to compete with the Holy Spirit. That's what you see. Holy Spirit does not need our competition. He needs our cooperation. So I want you to cooperate with the Holy Spirit for the next few minutes. Don't try to compete. Because if you compete, I won't stop you. Okay? He doesn't need your competition. He wants your cooperation. A lot of people in the past, what has happened, it used to be like that day when I said I heard the message in tongues from the church. That used to happen all the time. Yeah. But then, after a while, you knew there was a weekly person, that he was a designated tongue talker. And then you knew there was a designated interpreter over there. It was like clockworks. After a while, you go, wait a minute. Does God only speak tongues to that person? Does God only speak to them? Because what they were doing, they were bringing attention to themselves. They were competing with the Holy Spirit. That's why I turned people off, including me. Okay? But when I had my own experience, see, God had to bypass all the people that were weird in that church to talk to me directly in my language, to make himself real to me. That's what he did, and he will do the same for you today. Listen, it's one thing, the first step is to get saved. Then you need the power to live a saved life. That's why some people get saved every week at the altar. Every week you see same people get saved at the altar. Why? Because they don't have the sustaining power of the Holy Spirit to sustain them when things go wrong. Amen. When the temptations of the world come in. You need the power of the Holy Spirit to live a saved life. Those of you that are in phase one or phase two, if you don't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, you are operating on a handicap. But when you receive the power of the Holy Spirit, baptism in the Holy Spirit, he'll give you the power to resist. He will give you the power to make the right decision. But you have to make that connection with him first. And that's what he wants for you. Okay? How many of you pray? Everybody. Great. How many of you know how to pray every time?
Oh, the hands went down.
Yes, okay. Why? Because most of us don't know how to pray. That's what the Bible says in Romans 8. When you don't know how to pray, when you don't know what to pray for, the Spirit Himself will pray through you with groanings that you know not of. Most of my prayer time now, 80% is in tongues. And I have no idea what I'm praying, but I know what I'm praying about. But I don't know what I'm praying. Because at my best knowledge, I don't know how to pray. I'm limited. Last few days, we've had lightning and thunder. Remember? Have you seen that? Have you seen lightning and thunder? What happens when we have thunder and lightning? You see first you see a light. Real. Everything just lights up at night. Then you count. Depending on how far that was, 10 seconds, 15 seconds, you hear. That's the difference between the speed of sound and the speed of light. The speed of sound travels at 1,126 feet per second. But light travels at 186,000 miles per second. That's the difference between when you pray in your understanding and when you pray in the Holy Ghost. Okay. Because who are we praying to? We're praying to God. We are reaching to Him. That's how our prayer is so much it goes on steroids. Your prayers get steroids. You become a supernatural person. So now, something also happens when we receive baptism of the Holy Spirit. Our spirit connects with the Holy Spirit. Listen, people ask me this question, didn't I receive the Holy Spirit when I got saved? Yes, you did. You received Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He came and He deposited a portion of His Spirit within you. When you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, you get the fullness of the Spirit. Baptism, the word baptismal means fully immersed. Okay? Fully immersed. That means you have to be fully immersed under something. Bapto means dipping in water. When you go to a restaurant and they give you olive oil, you take the bread and you dip it. And you eat it. That's called bapto. But baptismal is being soaked completely underneath and remaining in that. Okay? The word baptismal, the root word of it comes from the word which means pickling. Okay? That means when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, you must remain in the Spirit. That's when the change comes. A pickle, when it first put in the substance, is a cucumber. If you just dip it in there, pick it up, and it's still a cucumber. But you leave that cucumber in that, a month or two later, it becomes a pickle, very soft. The properties completely changes. That's what happens when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit and you remain in the Spirit. How is it possible to remain in the Holy Spirit? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Jude 20 talks about it. Edifying yourself in the Holy Ghost. You do it all the time. It's not a one-time experience. Some of you will experience it for the first time, but it's not a one-time experience. Baptism is being filled. When it says be filled with the Spirit, it's being filled. That means constantly you must fill yourself. People say, didn't I receive the Holy Spirit? Yes, you did. But tell you what, the Bible says we have this treasure in this earthen vessel, that the excellency of God may be of Christ, not of ours. Earthen vessel, He called us. Why? Because earthen vessels leak. I try to talk to people about baptism of the Holy Spirit. A pastor, 20 years older than me, 30 years older than me. Oh, Sonny, I received the Holy Spirit 40 years ago. I go, really? He must have leaked out. Because I don't see any fruit. I don't see any power. I see nothing. Joe, so what? You spoke in tongues one time. So what? You babbled. The fruit is a changed life. Amen. People say the evidence is speaking in tongues. That's just one. The real evidence is a changed life. This is what I was, this is what I am today. And it's because of the Holy Spirit. So it's not a one-time experience. It's an ongoing thing. It starts out. And folks, there's three baptisms, by the way. First baptism is baptism in Christ, when you receive Him. Where the Holy Spirit draws you, and He takes you, and He baptizes you in Christ. You go in Christ, Christ comes in you, you become, that's the moment of salvation. The second baptism is baptism in water. After you get saved, you profess in front of everybody, you declare to the whole world that you are saved, that you are following Christ now. You get baptized in water, the old nature goes under, new nature comes up. That's declaring to the whole world. But the third baptism, which is the highest form of baptism, is baptism in the Holy Spirit, where Christ Himself comes and takes you and baptizes you in His Spirit, fully immersed. And that's what He wants to do with you right now. Folks, let me tell you, when the Word of God gets deep inside you, when we come sold out for God, nothing else matters. That's why your pastors here do what they do. They're sold out completely to God. Because they know that they know that they know that's what God has done. For them, there's no other alternative. Sometimes it's difficult. Hasn't always been easy, has it, Pastor Louie? You know, Pastor, I don't know. You still fight battles. You still do all that. But let me tell you, when you have the power of the Holy Spirit, He sustains you. You stay. It's not always easy when God gives you a calling. And God has calling for many of you. I don't know what it is, what calling He has for you. But He has for many of you a calling. Don't be scared of the calling. Ask the Holy Spirit to show you what it is. Okay? He has you here because He has given you a testimony. And your testimony is what opens the door to many people. Most of you can minister to people that I can never minister to. Because your circle is different than my circle. Okay? So God has brought you here from this place for a purpose. And He wants to talk to you. Listen, when God gives you a vision, it's not always easy. Sometimes it scares the daylights out of you. When He told me He wanted me to be a pastor, it scared the daylights. I wanted to run. But let me tell you, I'm so glad I didn't, because I would have lived a miserable life. You can live a life outside of the will of God, but you will be miserable. Listen, there was a minister in the Bible, a young prophet named Jeremiah. God called him to a huge task when he was young, 18 years old. He told him, I want you to go, I want you to rebuke these elders. It's just like going and standing in front of the Assembly of God, General Council, and saying, but thus saith the Lord, you guys need to repent or whatever. Imagine, 18 years old. So of course, he was scared. And he said, and Jeremiah said, Lord, wherever I go, it causes problems. Every time I bring you up, it causes problems. You can read for yourself in Jeremiah chapter 20. But this, I have to do this, because I need both hands. It's called improvisation. He says in chapter 20 of Jeremiah, he said, Lord, I tried to put your word down, but he goes, your word was so deep down inside of me that every time I try to walk away from it, it shot out of my bones like a fire. This is what happens when the Holy Ghost gets inside you. Listen, when you get saved, you get the Holy Spirit. When you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, He gets you. And today He wants to get you. And He wants to show you the plans that He has for your life. Jeremiah 29:11. Plans He has for your life to give you hope and a future. Listen, we can put this out at any time by closing it. It's our choice. I can walk away from the will of God at any time. Or, after a while, this thing runs out of fuel. No matter how hard I want it to work, it's going to run out of fuel. So the only way it's going to run, the fire in here, is my meat keep putting more fuel in it. The only way you're going to be able to run this race that God has for you is by fueling yourself every day. How do you do it? By the power of the Holy Ghost. By receiving from Him, by drinking from Him every day. And that's what He wants to do for you right now. One prerequisite in receiving baptism of the Holy Spirit, the only prerequisite, is to know Him as your Lord and Savior. It's you've given your life to Him. Because I don't know all of you right now, we're going to take care of that. Okay? Quick and simple. Doesn't have to be a long prayer. Repeat after me and mean it with all your heart, loud and clear. Dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
I ask you to come into my heart.
I
make you my Lord and Savior.
Thank you for dying for me.
So I can live a victorious life.
Help me to live for you.
And do the things you want me to do. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
If you said that prayer now for the first time, that makes you eligible to receive this gift that God has for you. Okay, let me have that one more time. Yeah. Now, a gift, folks, is only a gift. Okay? I can stand over here. I have a gift for you. Pastor Wall, I have a gift for you. Pastor Wall, I have a gift for you. There you go. It's only a gift, but it becomes your gift when you take it and you accept it. Now it's up to you. What are you going to do with that gift? You're eligible to receive the gift. Folks, and this gift of baptism of the Holy Spirit is the greatest gift after salvation. Salvation first, then baptism of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, it's up to you. Do you receive the gift? Then after that, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to open it, use it, or what? Have you ever received gifts that you never opened because based on the last five gifts that person gave you, you knew it was no good? But let me tell you, this gift that God wants to give to you is the best gift because He is a giver of the greatest gifts. And you need to make sure you open this right away and put it to use. So, you're eligible to receive the gift. You already met the prerequisite. The next thing is that you must believe it's for you. Do you believe it's for you? Because if you don't believe it's for you, it's not going to force it. The next thing is that you must desire the gift. Do you desire the gift? You desire the gift. If you don't desire the gift, that means you are happy living the way you're living now. You don't want a better life. You don't want greater power. The next thing is that you must ask for the gift with your own mouth. And the final thing is that you must do the speaking. God is not going to move your mouth for you. Okay? Some people stand there. I've seen it with the mouth all clenched up. If God wants me to speak in tongues, He'll move. No, He's not going to move your mouth. He didn't force you to get saved. You did it willingly. Same way you must receive baptism in the Holy Spirit. And when you receive baptism of the Holy Spirit, listen, there's not going to be any feeling. You're not going to see any fire. Okay, none of that stuff. And we're not talking literally. But what you receive the power. The Bible says in Acts 1 that you shall receive power of the Holy Ghost come upon you. That word power is not physical power. Sometimes we need physical power. He gives it to us. Yes. But that word is ability to do. Ability to understand. Ability to stand when things go wrong, ability to discern, ability to do the right thing. And that's what He'll give to you, ability. After you receive the Holy Ghost, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost come upon you. That's what He wants to give you, the power to overcome, the power to say no, the power to change, the power to stand. That's what He wants to give to you today. It has nothing to do with what you're thinking, if this makes any sense. Well, everything I've told you makes no sense in your mind. It never made any sense to me in my mind. So I want you right now to do a mind bypass. You've heard of a heart bypass. I want you to do a mind bypass. Let it go straight to your heart. Don't let those thoughts in your head right now to stop you from receiving this. You met the prerequisite. You ask Christ into your heart. You believe it's as if that's for you. You desire the gift. Right now, fourth thing. Ask for the gift with your own mouth. Right now, out loud, say, Jesus, baptize me in your Holy Spirit. If you said that and you meant it right now, this is the final. This is where the rubber meets the road. You must do the speaking. God's not going to move your mouth for you, and your mouth is the faucet that opens the flow. The Bible says, out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. The Holy Spirit that's deep inside you, when you receive Him, when He wants to come up, bubble out of your mouth, okay, And when the flow comes, that's when the power starts to flow. You'll never be the same after that. Don't try to figure it out right now. So if you want to receive the gift that you just asked for, I want you to stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Open your mouth wide. Psalms 81:10 says, open your mouth wide and I will fill it for you. You sense there's something resonating inside you. Something wants to bubble up out of you. That's the Holy Spirit of God.